everybody. It's your girl, Tuwana B, with Not Your Normal Conversation. Today, I'm sitting here with Sean Ellis and Attorney Scapicchio. How are you guys doing today?
Doing great, thanks.
I'm good. How are you?
I am well. Thank you for asking. So, Sean, thank you for coming on the show. It's been a long time coming. I feel like I've been chasing you around for a little bit, trying to get you to come on so we can kind of share your story with everybody. I think people need to hear from you. So we'll get started. I don't want to waste any more of your time. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Perfect. So Sean, you have a Netflix series out right now, Trial 4. And I actually got a chance to watch it. I actually watched it a couple of times, not just once. And I was impressed with how you shared your story with us. It was almost as if you were telling the story. It was almost as if you were sitting there talking to me. So thank you for sharing your story. And Rosemary, thank you for being a part of that. There's a lot of people that needed to hear that there's a lot of injustice in the justice system. So Sean, I'm just gonna ask you some questions and we can just go from there. Can you just tell me where you grew up and what your childhood was like?
I grew up in my younger years in Rosendale section of Boston. Mm-hmm. After that, when I was around eight, my mom ended up moving to a house in Dorchester. So that was the first time that I transitioned from a brick building to a house.
Right.
And so, you know, that was kind of big for me and my family.
So have you lived in the Boston area your whole life? You've lived in Massachusetts your whole life? Is this where you were born and raised?
Born and raised, yes.
Right. So I'm sure a lot of people watching and a lot of people that know you, they know your story and they know the things that you've encountered over the years. So at the age of 19 years old, you hadn't had much experience with the justice system, if any at all. What was your initial reaction when you were being arrested and the charges, when you heard the charges of why you were being arrested? What went through your head the night that you got arrested?
So as a 19-year-old, it's like I wasn't able to really process the magnitude of what was going on. Like I couldn't process the magnitude of facing a charge where the punishment was to spend the remainder of my natural life incarcerated. Right. So like I wasn't able to process that part of it. Right. But you know, there was a tremendous amount of fear that was present. But in my naivety, I thought that things would be okay. That the justice system would work. You know what I mean? And that I would be found not guilty at trial, but that, you know, it's far from what happened. You know, it's you know, you go from the, like, I'm never going to be arrested, right, to the, all right, well, I'm going to go to court and I'm going to be let out of court.
Right.
You know what I mean? And then like that part of it doesn't happen.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's you deal with a whole lot. Like, even as I talk to you, this is like, you know, kind of like the reliving, you know, that like trauma from then, you know, so.
Right. So as a 19-year-old who'd never been incarcerated, who said they would never be arrested, never be a part of the system, you now at 19 years old are faced with a natural life sentence. And at that point, you had no knowledge of the justice system and how it worked. And you went in believing and trusting that eventually the truth would come out and you wouldn't be there for very long. So right. To you, it seemed like something that they could work out within the police department and the justice system and all would be well, but that didn't end up being the case.
Right. And so it's at that exact point that it turns into a fear. Like it's kind of like being like kidnapped. Like if you can imagine yourself like being kidnapped or just taken, and like that, like fear of what is this person doing with my life?
Right.
You know, it happens at that point.
Right. In parts of the Trial 4 series, I noticed you had a lot of family support each and every time you went to court. There was a lot of people, the community, very present. At that point in time, did you have a public defender or did you have private counsel when you went in?
Well, I think that Rosemary can speak about the particulars of that and like how that works, because I believe that it was like that there were private attorneys, but there was something, there was some workings about like how that works, where, because I couldn't afford to pay an attorney at that time.
Correct. So Attorney Scapicchio, can you just explain to me when he first initially got taken into custody, did he have private counsel or was it just an attorney that the court awarded him at the time of his arraignment?
So he had Norman Zelkom and David Duncan appointed to his case because it was a police officer homicide. There were actually two people from Norman's firm, him and David, that took the case. They're private lawyers. They don't work directly. They're not employees of the Committee for Public Counsel Services, but they take court-appointed cases. So they're in private practice. They take court-appointed cases, and they got assigned to Sean's case. And I think did a great job of trying to put him in the best possible position to succeed. Unfortunately for them, they didn't have the evidence that the Boston Police Department had about the corruption and about the tip line that would have made a difference, I think, in Sean's trial.
Exactly. So, Sean, was there ever a time that you thought you were going to spend your life in prison for a crime you didn't commit? And if so, did that change you in any way? Did it change your outlook on how you looked at people? Because it appeared even in the documentary that you, besides, you know, being around your cousins and your family, you were pretty innocent. And you know, you didn't spend a lot of time in the streets per se. So did it make you view people and the level of trust that you have for people, did that go away?
Yes. Yes. So it's you know, when after I was convicted, you know, my faith and my hope went into, you know, the motion, the initial motion for new trial that we had filed. And then from that, it's like, well, all right, that motion went back in front of the trial judge, who I looked at as somebody that was, you know, biased and was not fair. And so it went to, all right, my trust and my hope and my faith is in the direct appeal that I was granted in the SJC at that time, and just hoping that they would do the right thing. And when that didn't happen, I think that was the like height, if you will, of like my anxiety or my fear that like my life was kind of gone.
Right.
You know what I mean? It was like, that was really a dark period for me. And so, did I ever lose hope? I can't say 100% that I lost hope, but it was at that point that I knew that I had to learn how to defend myself within the system, because the system wasn't going to work for me.
But not knowing a lot about the system and not really knowing how it was designed, and also knowing just in a short period of time that it wasn't going to work for you, what did you put your faith in? Who did you trust? Because you had two attorneys. I don't believe Rosemary was on your case at that point in time, because this would have never happened. But because she wasn't, you had to kind of lean on somebody. And this was a big case. It was in the news and the media for a long time. And you were already tried and convicted before you were even seen before a jury or anything. So people already said that you were guilty until proven innocent. There was no innocent until proven guilty. So
that's how it started out.
Right. And you're 19 and 20 years old and you have nobody to trust. So what did you do and how did you spend your time while you were waiting and holding on to the little bit of hope that you would come home?
So who did I trust? I trusted myself, because I had to. Like my mom was there, my cousin Putin was there, And you know, I have family members there. But it's like I put my trust in myself initially. Like I said, because I had to, because the system wasn't working. You know, the system that you know I was raised to believe was gonna work for me and be fair and give me justice didn't give me that justice. And it isn't like it was an accident that you know, it isn't like nobody knew. The system didn't work because there was intentional acts that were done by people,
right,
that caused the system to not work. Right. So it isn't like I don't want to have a conversation thinking that, you know, the system worked the way that it was supposed to work, and just this is a low percentage of, let's call it, the imperfection within the system. No, like this is what happened to Sean Ellis is a problem within the system itself.
Absolutely. I actually want to play a clip from trial 4 just in case no one's seen it before, but I believe they have. I've watched it, and I'm not even going to lie. I think I almost broke my TV a couple of times. I cried. I wanted to throw the TV out the window when I heard some of the police officers talking. I thought it was disgusting. I was very appalled that somebody's life was on the line and nobody was doing anything to stop what was happening with you. And at 19 years old, you would think. Now, I said this to you before our interview, and I've said it to you in conversation. We've had plenty of conversation. I went to jail because I committed a crime. I knew that there was a chance that I could get caught and go to prison. It was a chance that I took. You, on the other hand, did not commit a crime. And you were put inside of a cage like an animal. And there didn't seem to be any end in sight. So I'm gonna just play a clip from trial 4, if you don't mind. Rosemary, do you mind if I play a clip from there?
Not at all.
Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and play a clip. Okay. Sorry. I the public negatively on some very honest and honorable police officers who were involved in the investigation of this case. My decision is not intended to excuse the reputation. Having said that, I feel strong about what I said in my decision that your client, Mr. Ellis, did not get a phone call.
Sean Ellis is just 19 years old. I was a reporting result today, 5 years. I was suspected to see him. They were being charged with a murder of Detective John Mulligan back in 1993.
I'm going to stop it right there. Sorry, guys. Sean, when you saw that, how did that make you feel watching just that alone?
That isn't necessarily like a fair question to ask, because there's so many feelings, you know. But it's one of the biggest ones is like, you know, I was overfilled with like joy at having the opportunity to like go back and, you know, prove my innocence.
Right.
You know, to have that chance to because I was railroaded the first time. Not only was I railroaded the first time, but like I was a 19-year-old child. I was a 19-year-old child. So this was being done to me by like grown people in the system. So it's to hear those words from Judge Ball, just it brought up a lot, because along with the joy, it was that like damn, like I shouldn't have been in there in the first place. But
the look on your face, you had no expression. It was hard for me to kind of see that you were excited, that you were going to be released after all these years. There was nothing.
You know something? I was still in a fight. It was like a moment to be able to like appreciate and to take in, but at the same time, like I'm still fighting for my life. I'm still traumatized by a system that brutalized me to begin with.
Right.
So there's a processing process that was going on there.
Right. So the justice system failed you. The Boston police failed you. The DA's office and the court system all have been a part of your freedom being taken away for a long period of time. This wasn't just a couple of years. This was a long period of time. Would you ever tell someone that was in your position or where you once were to trust this broken system or to believe that it could work for them?
Do you know something? I'm trying to think of how I want to phrase this, but I like to know from Rosemary what she experienced as my defense attorney, seeing what happened to me. You know, like how would she answer that question?
Yeah. Attorney Scapicchio, how would you answer that question? Because I mean, you've been an attorney for quite some time, and I, prior to seeing Sean Ellis in the news with you, I've seen you in the news before. And how, now I'm going to rephrase the question since Sean didn't answer it. Do you take on any of these emotions of your client when you see the injustice in the system, and you already know from an attorney standpoint, you already see the paperwork coming in or not coming in. You know what they're giving you and what they're not giving you. You already see the writing on the wall. Do you take in any of what your client is feeling, knowing that as you go home every day, your client is locked up for a crime that he did not commit?
Yes, you do take on those emotions. You can't help it. You're human. And you know, anytime someone sits across from me and tells me that they didn't do this, it's almost like an anxiety that takes over your whole body about, okay, now how am I going to fix it? And when I first met Sean, I had, you know, probably an hour and a half, maybe a 2-hour conversation with him. And I walked out of the jail that day convinced that he didn't do it, And I had read some about his case, but not a lot. And so you think at that point, he was years into his sentence, and his direct appeal had already been denied. His motion for a new trial had already been denied. So now we have to, you know, if I'm right, and I believed I was, because I believe Sean didn't do this, and I knew he didn't do it, then my job now is to find the evidence that proves his innocence. And that's not an easy task when you're fighting the entire Boston Police Department, you're fighting the district attorney's office, you're fighting every lab that you ask for information from, every internal affairs record, every anti-corruption record. They fought us tooth and nail for years to keep from us the information that would have opened those cell doors to him years and years and years before. And so you can't help but be frustrated with them. You can't help but understand they're gonna spend another Christmas in jail for a crime they didn't commit. They're gonna spend another summer in a hot, disgusting place with no air conditioning and sometimes no ability to get any fresh air. And so, you know, it definitely takes its toll on you, because you can't help but feel what they feel. And at the same time, you know, in my practice, I'm always cognizant of keeping the family very updated in terms of what's going on. So you had to make the phone call to his mother and to his sister and say, here's what's going on now. And this is what we expect is going to happen. And this is what, you know, the judge said, and this is what we hope is going to happen. And this is the evidence that we found. And so, you know, to try to keep hope in a situation that appears sometimes very hopeless. And it seems, you know, when it takes you 12 years to get freedom of information records, you would think at some point, you know, somebody would have thrown up their hands and said, forget it. But we were so committed and so invested in proving Sean's innocence. Right. It wasn't anything that was going to let us, you know, that was going to stand in our way. And so my job was to find the evidence, and it took some time, but we did it.
And I know that you and Sean watched my interview with D.A. Rollins. She did say that you did an excellent job of not giving up, and she was disappointed that her office or the Boston Police Department did not give you what you needed in order for Sean to have a fair trial.
Well, in essence, if they had given us the tip lines, and when I say us, I'm talking about Norman Zalkheim and Dave Duncan, way back in the very beginning, trial one, if they had given us those tip lines, what Judge Ball said and what the SJC said is it would have been a game changer.
Right.
Given us the information that connected Mulligan to the corruption, it would have been a game changer. And it's not that they didn't have the information. They absolutely had the information, but they hid it from us. And the frustration is that, you know, Sean spent 22 years in jail for a crime he didn't commit. And the people who actually committed this homicide got away with it because no one was looking for them for the last 22 years. Exactly. And I can tell you, no one's still looking for them.
Exactly.
Because the way that they released Sean wasn't that, oh my God, we're so sorry that this happened to you.
Right.
Oh my God, we can't believe that we hid this evidence from you. That was another administration. We won't tolerate that. It wasn't that at all. Everybody stood up and said, we think he did it. We just can't prove it. And thankfully he's still convicted of the gun so that he can't sue us about this. And he's still a convicted felon, and that we take some comfort in the idea that he's still a convicted felon. And how they come to that conclusion and make those statements in a you know, in a press conference after Judge Ball had written the decision that she wrote, and after seven judges of the SJC, and in an opinion written by Justice Gantz, who just recently passed away, saying there's no other conclusion you can come to except that the evidence was withheld. And it would have made a difference. And so Sean sat in jail legitimately for 21 years while they hid this evidence from him time after time. It wasn't that we weren't asking. As soon as I got involved, we started asking. So
now you did.
So you know, they stonewalled us for 12 years to the point where I had to file a civil suit against the Boston Police Department to try to get the Freedom of Information documents that are supposed to be public documents. They're supposed to be what you turn over in the public, and we still didn't get it. And then if you watch trial four, you see like day four of the hearing, they finally come in with the anti-corruption file. While the cop that I want to talk to is on the witness stand. Like, what am I, Evelyn Wood? I'm supposed to get through this whole pile of information to be able to cross-examine them? That's so unfair when you're dealing with someone's freedom and you're dealing with someone's life, that it should not be accepted. And the way that they, you know, they not only screwed Sean because they put him away for a crime he didn't commit, they screwed him when they dismissed the case against him because, you know, they held this press conference where they said, we're not sorry. And if we're not sorry,
yes,
we don't ever have to take own what we did.
Right.
We never have to take responsibility for what happened. And we don't have to investigate and find out what happened, because
right,
we're going to hold this press conference and say, we think he did it. We just can't prove it. And we're so grateful he's still convicted of the gun, because that gives us some peace and it gives the family some peace. Well, how does the family have peace when the wrong man is convicted for anything that has to do with this case?
Right.
I just don't follow the logic at all.
Exactly.
And so to answer your question, like after hearing that and after seeing what I've gone through as reflected throughout trial four, how can I really put trust into a system that is set up to not work for me? It's already demonstrated that. The problem is that we're supposed to teach, we are ourselves supposed to trust the system and teach our offspring to trust the system.
Right.
But if the system doesn't work and no one's fixing it, then what do you do?
Now, do you think that the system just didn't work for you because there was corrupt police officers on this case and there was a corrupt police officer that passed away? Or do you think that this had something to do with just because it was in the Black and brown community and there was a white cop who was murdered and they believe that you did it? Because that to me is a game changer in any case when you're talking about race. So do you think that it was just the case itself and the players, or do you believe it was because you were Black?
It's the Sean Ellis case is no different from the Charles Stewart case when it comes to race.
Okay.
The biggest difference between the two is that me and my naivety as far as the workings of the system said, yeah, I was there at Walgreens that night buying diapers.
Right.
Like that isn't a crime. It never has been a crime.
Right. You've been pretty positive. I have seen you in the community, and I said this to you in private, and I'll say it now on this platform. I would still be bitter and I would be pissed off. And I would be looking for somebody's head to be rolling if I had to spend 21 years of my life in jail for a crime that I did not commit. You are very humble. And it's to be applauded that I see you in the community trying to help other people that were once just like you. I see you everywhere. On Zoom conferences, I've chimed in on some just to watch you, just to see if there's anything from you that would make me think that you're a little bit bitter about what happened. And I haven't seen any from the time that I met you. You know, what was really ironic to me was when I saw you passing out toys with my uncle, who was a Boston police officer, and you were my Facebook friend, and I didn't text you yet. I called my uncle and I said, you know who that is? And he goes, yeah, I do. I go, that's the guy that they accused of killing a Boston police officer. He started laughing. My uncle's a cop first. I've never known him as my uncle, only as a cop. So for him to say, I don't think he did it, was enough for me to know that you didn't do it. This is a guy who would arrest his own mother if he had to. So for him to say that about you, as I said to you before, spoke volumes to me and how I proceeded to say, this is just not right. Like, if I wasn't on paper right now, Sean, I would be somewhere at, like, the White House or the State House picketed because of what they did to you, because it's not okay. But your attitude has been so positive. How do you stay like this? Like, what is it that you did to keep yourself in this frame of mind? Because there's a lot of people that I've talked to about you that would be looking for monetary money, because 21 years is a long time. And they would be looking for all these other things, but yet and still, you've remained positive and decided to go out into the community, share your story, and help other people. How do you remain like that?
What is so? So, there is the internal answer to that. And some people may not be able to relate to the internal answer to that. But the offsprings or one of the results of the internal reality is this: to be bitter and do what? Be bitter and appear how? You know what I mean? It's in being bitter is me really allowing what happened to me to be perpetuated, like just in my life. So that harm and that hurt, it's like I owe it to myself to at least try to fight back against that. And you may see me as like polished or I may appear as though like just life is just business as usual, but there's an internal part of that that's really not seen, that's really not public. And so every day is not a good day. And just because I don't choose to project or portray myself to be a better individual doesn't mean that I'm not dealing with, you know, the effects of that internal trauma.
Right. because I saw you had great support from your family, from community, from your longtime girlfriend, from all of these people. And what kind of toll did it take on your family, your mom especially? She was a great support and stood by you from the very beginning and said, now I have, you know, I have a child. And so, of course, you always want to think that your child would never do anything to harm anybody. But she was very adamant and not just saying, well, this is my child, so I know that he didn't do it. She was speaking to something else in you that said, he didn't do this. It wasn't just about, I know my child, he didn't do this. This was about, he didn't do this, and I know that he didn't do it. Your mom and your family has been by your side from the very beginning. How do they feel now that you're home?
So as far as my mom, and my cousin, you know, we call her Pudding. That's not her real name, but you know, she's Pudding, my cousin Pudding. But you know, it's initially and very, very early on and for a long time, like my mom had to live with the weight of having her son in prison accused of a cop killing. Like that's a weighty reality for one to have to bear under. Right. You know what I mean? And my mom had to bear that reality as well, from her own standpoint, as far as having a son. And so, you know, there was times and periods in my life where, you know, I wasn't necessarily spoke of in a social way outside of the confines of family.
Right.
You know, you have a conversation within family and people are asking, well, yeah, well, how's Sean doing this, that, and the third? But how do you have a conversation with somebody that you're just meeting that you don't know in a new community and say, yeah, well, I have a 5-year-old daughter and I have a 20-something-year-old son who is incarcerated serving life for the murder of a Boston police officer, but I know he didn't do it. Like until you can prove that, you know, you're not able to walk, you know, just proudly. And so for my mom to have the opportunity, you know, today to be able to walk proudly, knowing that I had nothing to do with the murder, you know, is a great thing.
It is. And it's a great thing for you. And there's a lot of people that stand with you and support you. I'm one of your biggest cheerleaders. Trust me. And I told you when this is over, I'm going to be standing with you because you have a t-shirt that says wounded, not broken. Is that what your t-shirt said?
Yeah, wounded, but not broken.
It just speaks volumes to your situation. You are a very humble guy, even when you don't see it. Being in the community, I, you know, I don't know how you even filmed the Netflix series, being back in that same courtroom where you were, there was a hung jury, and then finally they convicted you. And I watched a juror say, they only did that because they didn't convict them the other time, so we had to do something. It wasn't that even they thought that you were guilty, they just knew that they had to do something. How did that feel for you to hear that they just had to do something? Not even for certain that they thought that you were guilty, but they had to do something. So that's what they did.
Yeah, I don't recall that part. My memory of that part, you know, was that it was one mistrial. It was in between one mistrial and another mistrial, and them having to fight that feeling. But I don't believe that was part of the jury that convicted.
So the jury that convicted you didn't take very long. They came back pretty quickly, correct?
Right.
When they brought you downstairs after a couple of hours, because it didn't take a full day, right? It just took a couple of hours for them to come back?
Yeah, I believe 3 hours.
What did you think was going to happen? Did you know that they were going to come back and say that you were guilty?
Not at all. You say what I think was going to happen. I thought that I was going to be found not guilty, that there was going to come to the conclusion that I didn't have anything to do with the murder, and that I was going to go home. Like I was still naive when it comes to the working of the system, even though each step of the way it's failing me and it's showing me that it's not going to work. Even at that point, you know, I'm still thinking, well, okay, this system like here is going to work.
Rosemary, you had the weight of the world on your shoulders because you were his last hope, basically. If you didn't come through, we wouldn't be having this conversation. So how much of this affected your day-to-day life as far as this case and knowing that you had to push through and you were it for not just him, but his family and everybody that loved him? Like you fought, I saw you fighting for documents and you were not okay with the fact that they weren't giving things up. And you were starting to uncover things that they were trying to hide for many, many years. Like, how did this all feel for you? You had like the whole world was on your shoulder. His life was in your hands at that point.
It is. And it's like that in almost every murder case that you take on. You literally have to be the shield between the Commonwealth, the Boston Police Department, and your client. And if they're going to get to your client, they have to go through you. That's the role, I think, of a good criminal defense attorney. And so when we're searching for these documents, when we're experiencing all this frustration, you know, Sean and I knew, and Jalise McDonough, who was from my office, who did a fabulous job, when we're searching for these documents and they're coming trickling in and we know there's more out there and we keep pushing and pushing and pushing. We all knew that by the time we got in front of Judge Ball and we were able to get the evidentiary hearing, that it wasn't going to get any better than that. That's as good as it was going to get for Sean's case. Mm-hmm. And we thought that we accomplished our goal of being able to expose the corruption, the goal of being able to prove that the trial attorneys didn't have this information, and our goal of connecting Mulligan to the corruption. We were pretty confident that we had done that, but it's a cop killing. And anytime it's a cop killing, you can't be confident about what a judge or the SJC is ultimately gonna do, because sometimes the rules change for people who are convicted of cop killing. And it was just so, when you talked about race earlier, it was just so much easier for the community to believe that a black kid killed a white cop.
Right.
And it was such an easy sell for them that a black kid killed a white cop that they didn't want to look anywhere else. The evidence led in all of these other directions that didn't have Sean anywhere near it. But you know, most of those people were not black, were not poor, and were not easy to manipulate. And you know, that's what we had here. And so in terms of, do you know you have the weight of the world on your shoulders? Always. You know, you walk into it understanding that this is it. And when we finally got the decision from Judge Ball that she was going to grant a new trial, Jalise and I were actually on trial in another homicide case. Mm-hmm. And so we needed to get up to the jail as quickly as we could to be able to tell Sean. My biggest fear is that he would find out through somebody else, not through us. And so we raced up to the jail after court. And we're sitting in the attorney room waiting for him to come. And when you visit in a state prison, they announce you have an attorney visit over the PA.
Yes.
Attorney visit for Sean Ellis, attorney visit. So everybody knows I'm there at that point. And so we're waiting and waiting and waiting. And Sean was always a client who never kept me waiting, ever. Like if they said attorney visit, he was there within 5 minutes.
Right.
He might have been in his gym clothes. He might have been walking the yard. He might have been in the law library. Whatever he was, he came because he had a tremendous amount of respect for myself and for Jalise and for the work we were doing in our time. And this night, it seemed like forever. We're waiting and waiting and waiting, and we're looking at the clock on the wall thinking, oh my God, he's not going to get out here before visits get over. And we're not going to be able to tell him. Like, how can this be? And so he finally does come. And when he walked in that room, he had the look of panic on his face because he knew, and we had a conversation about this later, but he knew this was his last chance. He knew that if Judge Ball said no, in all likelihood, he was going to spend the rest of his life in jail. And right. So I think that he walked as slow as he did because he didn't want to give up hope. And until he saw us, he still had that hope that he maybe someday he would go home. And when we finally said, we did it, you know, we did it, there was just such a tremendous amount of relief in him to understand that he's going to get a chance. You know, you're going to get a second chance here. And not many people get second chances like this. And just overwhelmed, the three of us literally sat in that attorney room until they kicked us out, which wasn't long enough in my mind, but you know, they don't care. They were corrections officers. They have, you know, they have their rules. But we sat in there just, you know, sort of basking in the idea that, you know, we had accomplished this. And now, you know, we knew the Commonwealth was going to appeal. We knew we had to fight it in the SJC, and we had to gear up for that as well. But right. We cracked that first barrier. And it was such an important barrier for us to crack. And we felt good and we felt confident about that. And I said to Sean, do you want to call your mother or do you want me to? And he said, you know, they're going to shut off my phone, so you have to call her. So I remember getting out of the jail, hopping in my car and calling his mother and calling his sister and saying, here's the situation. And they were just so relieved. And he was able to catch up with them the next morning and tell them. And then things moved very quickly from there. But you know, hope is a hard thing to maintain when you're in custody. And it's a hard thing to maintain when the system has failed you in the way that the system failed Sean.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that you know, frustrates me the most is that when you say, did the system fail because you're Black? Did the system fail because, you know, they were corrupt cops? The irony of the whole thing is that nobody is looking at why the system failed.
Right.
Nobody is looking into that, not the district attorney's office, not the police department. And so, you know, I always analogize it to a plane crash. When a plane crashes, everybody goes to the spot that the plane crashes. We find the black box. We figure out what happened. We have all these people working on it. And that's so that people feel comfortable getting on that next plane.
Absolutely.
We don't want to take that level of comfort away from them. Why right. don't we do that with the criminal justice system? Right. Why don't we have these, when we know there's epic failures that happened, why aren't we looking into how and why it happened? Because unless we do that, we cannot assure A, that it hasn't happened to other people, which we know it has.
Right.
How do we prevent it from happening until we understand how? We know race played a huge role in this.
We know that
corruption played a huge role in this. But how wide and how deep? We don't know because they won't look. They want to just pull the covers up and say, he did it, we can't prove it, let's move on.
Right. And as I said earlier, like, it happens, and it happened to Keon Sprinkles, it happened to Dow Jones, it happened to Victor Rosario, it happened to Nat, like, it happened to Ronnie Qualls, it's happening to Ricky McGee now, it's happening to Stephen Pena now, it's a problem with how that system is working. And it isn't going to stop working in that way until someone looks into why these things are happening.
And there's not enough attorney Scapicchios out there.
Oh, fact.
To make sure that this doesn't happen. So, Sean, you've done something that I commend you for, because, again, I've been following you. Like, you know, I wouldn't say a fan. I'm one of your biggest supporters, silently. Anybody that wants to hear, I ask anybody that I interview that's an attorney what they think about your case, because I want to know if they believe that what happened to you was an injustice or that something just got overlooked. Because if it was something that just got overlooked, that's a big deal. That's not a small thing. But now you work for the Innocence Project and you do a lot of work with them and you help people that were like you. And you go out to the community and you speak, and I see you on a lot of Zoom platforms, and I see you speaking out about the injustice in the system and how you don't want anybody to be you. So what made you decide to go into that line of work, seeing as though you spent 21 years of your life behind the law? Did you see anybody else that looked like you that was in the same predicament as you that is still behind the law today, and that you felt that you had to come out and not just fight for you, but fight for them too?
Yeah, and so I just named them, and I gave you, I name them again. Ricky McGee is somebody who had at this point been in prison for between 22 and 23 years.
Wow.
For a murder that I believe he did not commit. And one of the things about his case is there's a detective by the name of Daniel Keeler, who again, everybody knows has a history, but he's been allowed to sit on cases and taint cases and intimidate witnesses, right? Which is what happened in Phu Quan's case for Familia. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And everyone's just overlooking it.
Right.
And just acting as though it just didn't happen. There needs to be a mass looking of looking into all the cases that everybody knows who the dirty cops were. Everybody knows who the cops were that was planting evidence and setting people up. Everyone knows who it was. And if you don't, then you're not asking the right people. But you know, we need to look at those cases and find out, you know, what's going on. Steve Pina, another one. He just had a hearing, I think it was last week or the week before last, presenting DNA evidence that showed he didn't have nothing to do with nothing. It's like, come on.
So you, I've seen you in the community helping people like yourself. But I also have seen you working in the community, like when you did the toy drive with my uncle. He's a Boston police officer. And I'm sorry, I don't care if he's my uncle or not, I would not be doing any toy drive with him, because again, these are the people. And I had to remember, that's just like saying all Black people are the same, because I don't believe every cop is bad. But coming from where you came from, I've seen you do community work with Boston police officers before. And you don't appear to be standoffish, you're engaged. How are you able to do that? Because you already know my take on it. I would not be able to do that. I'm sorry. Everybody's guilty. Just like they said, you were guilty until proven innocent. They're all guilty too. And as far as I'm concerned, they all knew about it. That's how I feel. And no one's excluded from that when you're talking about 21 years of somebody's life. So how are you able to still do this, to still be in the community and speak to people like other Boston police officers and other people in authority and not feel any type of way at all, or it appears that you don't?
Yeah, so this is what I'll say to that. You know, it's I don't take the position that all cops are bad. Like, being a police officer is a job, just like being a doctor is a job.
Right,
just like being a defense attorney is a job. So, right. So you go about doing your job, and you in your fear about it, right? Then there's no problem. But when you go outside of the parameters of your job, just like when people go outside of the parameters of the law, that's when there's a problem. When you go outside of the parameters of what it is to be an officer, that's what the problem is. So right. When I encounter somebody such as your uncle, who I don't know to have gone outside or have a history of going outside of the parameters of his job, and then he approaches me as a human being, as an individual, then it's only right for me to approach him back in that way.
Right.
And so this isn't a crusade, Sean Ellis and Rosemary, against all police officers. Like, the problem here is there was a setup, there was a cover up, and there was corruption that permeated throughout this whole case, this whole investigation, and that's a problem, and that's what we're saying needs to be dealt with.
And I couldn't
agree with you
more.
And so, you know, I don't take the position that all cops are bad.
Well, just so you know, my uncle, before he retired, was a cop for over 30 years, and he said he never pulled out his service weapon ever. So I know that there's cops out there that don't necessarily have to take that road. I know that it's possible that you don't have to shoot to kill every person that you encounter. You don't have to lock up every person that you encounter. You're a community activist. You're a role model. You do a lot in the community. And I think that that's to be admired about you, Sean Ellis. There's a lot of people that look up to you and that stand with you. What's your next thing to do in the community? Because to me, it seems like you've done it all. You're speaking, you're always speaking out, sharing your story. Do I see a book coming or anything? Do I see any of that stuff coming down the line for you?
Yes, most definitely. You know, a book and who knows what else. But you know, is I just, you know, I want to circle back and you know, say this a little bit in reverence. It's like one of the problems is that when is that we as Black, one of the problems is when we as Black and brown people do not show up to work, right? Being our true and authentic self. When we feel as though we have to kind of like fit in to the system, because right. Now we're perpetuating, you know, what the mechanics of the system, we're perpetuating that. And right. It's only going to stop when we show up, no matter in what field it is, whether it's as a doctor, whether it's as a policeman, whether it's as a nurse, whether it's as a lawyer, whether it's at whatever it is. It's like, you know, we help to, you know, stop to perpetuating the perpetuation of systemic and structural racism by showing up as our true and authentic self. You know, and so that's in part because that's part of who I am. That's part of the work that I do in a community and just showing the younger people that they are loved and that they are cared for, so that they can grow and develop and be proud of who they are and stuff. So, you know,
there's hashtags, there's slogans, there's many people that speak out in your name. Does that overwhelm you at all? You're like a trend, like you're trending. Your hashtags are unbelievable. And I don't know if you're aware of it, but does that overwhelm you, the amount of support and the love that people show you daily?
What I'll say to that is that my kick-ass attorney on his car right now does a wonderful job of shielding me from everything I need to be shielded from.
She's a superstar. I don't think she knows. I don't know. She knows. She seems very humble, but you know, Attorney Scapicchio, I have to commend you and applaud you. And I, you know, I'm sure Sean and his family have said thank you, but not just for him, but for the way that you do your job. You're not just saying, okay, well, my client is innocent. You're saying, well, I'm going to prove to you, because just like you said that he was guilty, I'm going to prove to you that he's not guilty. And you don't stop. It's like you're relentless with this. You don't stop until you uncover whatever it is that needs to be uncovered. And I think that that's to be applauded. I see a lot of attorneys. I've done a lot of time. And unfortunately, I've seen a lot of attorneys that don't really care about their clients. It's like they're so bogged down in the system that they don't take the time to see that maybe their clients need something other than jail. And I think for you, you fight so hard. You're fighting for freedom. You're going for the gusto. There's no, I want my client to go for 2.5 years. There's no, I don't want him going at all. I thank you for the way that you fight for your clients and the way that you fight for injustice, whether it's the Boston police, whether it's the DA, whether it's the judge, whoever it is. And you always want to get to the bottom of it, no matter what. I would be afraid to be on the other end. I'm going to school to be an attorney now. And when I interviewed Rachel Rowland, she said, maybe I could be a DA. And if I had to come up against you, I'd probably quit. Because, and I'm being honest, because at this point, I've seen you be relentless and with good reason. So I thank you for that.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And we have to be relentless because there's no other choice. If we don't find the evidence, if we don't uncover the truth, then our clients die in jail. And that's not an option that I'm willing to entertain. If I take on a case, then I'm going to do everything in my power to find the evidence to prove their innocence, because I feel like it's my responsibility. It's my job. It's what they've hired me to do. And I'm not going to stop until I find it. And when I believe in my clients, and I do, and I believe in their innocence, there has to be evidence out there somewhere that says something different than what a jury heard in a courtroom someday. And so I'm not going to stop until I find it, because the alternative is to give up. And that's just not in my nature.
Not in mine either. So hopefully you'll have a place for me when it's all said and done, when I get out of school, and you're going to teach me everything you know, because you know a lot. And I just, Sean, I thank you. I have a sweatshirt made for you that I want to send to you. I told you this before. I just appreciate you, and I appreciate the work that you're doing in the community, and I appreciate the fact that you haven't given up. I know that you've heard many stories where there's been people who have gone to jail and they haven't committed crimes. They come out and their life is really hard and they don't know how to get back to normal society. And one guy in New York committed suicide. You know, I think that it's to be applauded. And this is a big deal. And I'm grateful that you're free. And I pray that whatever is going on in your future, that it doesn't hold you down. And there's great things to come for you. Attorney Scapicchio, thank you for coming on the show finally. And Sean, thank you for finally getting on the show. Is there anything you want to say to the people that are listening? Is there anything? And how do people, because there's probably people listening right now, I can't see the comments. You have to go back and look. You guys can go back and look and respond. But how do people get a hold of you? Like if they have family members that are incarcerated and they feel like they're wrongfully convicted of something, how do they go about getting involved in the Innocence Project? Or how does that work for somebody who has a family member that's incarcerated that needs this type of help? Because Rosemary has her hands full, so we don't, you know, how can we?
So they can either get in touch with me on my social media platform, either Ellis K. Sean or Sean K. Ellis, one of those variants on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, or YouTube. But they can also email me at Ellis. They can email me at Sean at, what is it? Sean at New England Innocence. .org.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah, so it's Sean at newenglandinnocence.org.
Perfect. And we thank you for that. Sean, I'm sure I'm going to be seeing more of you in the community. I always see you doing something. You're a pretty busy guy. So I thank you for coming on the show. I thank you for being open and honest with the questions that I ask. Attorney Scapicchio, it's very nice to meet you. I thank you for coming on the show. Everybody, you know how to find her. She's hot in the streets. Everybody knows who you are. I just thank you both. And I thank you for never giving up. And Sean, I thank you for never giving up. Never giving up on yourself, because that's to be applauded. And I'm going to stay tuned and see what's next for you. I'll text you to let you know that I'm going to send your sweatshirt. And you got to wear it. I want to see you wearing it. I want to see you post it and wear it. You have that big afro. It's actually the Trial 4 poster I had put on the sweatshirt just for you.
Okay.
So thank you. I appreciate you, and you guys have a good evening. And thank you everybody for tuning in to Not Your Normal Conversation. Stay tuned. Maybe next time I'll have Rosemary on by herself to answer some legal questions if she has time.
Sure, call me.
Yes, I will.
John will give you my cell.
Okay, thank you. You guys have an awesome evening. I thank you both. Stay blessed. Sean, stay active. We need more people like the both of you in the community.
Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you. Peace.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
You too. Bye-bye.